Hi everyone, welcome to Causality with Boris, broadcasting from Sobolev Spaces. In this video, I introduce a conceptual framework for causal analysis in health research. What's a conceptual framework? Here is my simple definition. It's a list of concepts to frame study questions and to interpret results. Intervention, treatment groups, summary measure, and effect size are the main things we talk about today. Let's begin with the notion of intervention. You don't have to study health for very long before you meet the term intervention. So, what's intervention? Well, really anything that improves health of individuals or entire population. For example, mass immunization is a public health intervention. In hospitals, it's quality improvement measures. Green spaces is environmental health intervention. In occupational health, it's training to lift patients avoiding back pain. In clinical epidemiology, intervention can refer to a new treatment, new medical device, or new service. What's intervention in your study? Tell me in comments. As you can see, health interventions come in many forms. Divided broadly, they are preventive or therapeutic. Preventive interventions stop diseases. Vaccination, for example, protects us from COVID-19. Therapeutic interventions, on the other hand, reduce disability caused by diseases. Angioplasty alleviates chest pain. Hip fracture surgery restores mobility. Whether preventive or therapeutic, our expectation is the same. Changes we make will improve our health. It's no surprise then that the most frequently asked question in health research is, what is the effect of intervention? Just one more thing. It occurred to me that you might have seen the term treatment in place of intervention. In my videos, I do the same. I use treatment and intervention interchangeably. Study and outcome variables are the first two elements of the causal inference framework. In health research, we begin by identifying study units. We then expose them to alternative treatments. The assumption is that any unit is eligible for any of the studied treatments. Now, the purpose of health research is comparing health status between patients who receive different treatments. By convention, these are collectively called treatment groups. When there are only two treatments, there are treatment group and control group. We use a study variable to represent treatment groups. With two treatments, it takes value 0 for the control group and 1 for the treatment group. It may seem an artificial construct, but study variables link interventions to changes in health. Intervention forces study variables to change from one value to another. Health status is then expected to respond to this change. Treatment response is an outcome, and there are two types of outcomes in health research: related to patients and related to treatments. Patient-related outcomes refer to changes in mobility, self-care, emotional state, or self-perception of health. Treatment-related outcomes refer to physiological changes in the body as a result of treatment. The outcome variable is often an indicator of the outcome's occurrence. When the outcome of interest occurs, the indicator takes value 1. Otherwise, it remains 0. The outcome variable can be continuous as well. Test results, vitals measurements, or time to side effects all have a range of values. Now, we need a summary measure to see if outcomes are different in treatment groups. Here's the thing. Individual results may vary. That's what drug advertising tells us, right? The same treatment for the same disease by the same physician may produce different individual results. Individual results vary. So, we need a statistic to summarize this variation. Mean, probability and rate, all used in health research. The mean is an expected value that the outcome tends to center around. Probability describes how often outcome occurs. And rate shows the number of occurrences per time unit. Back to our question, what is the effect of intervention? To answer it, we compare the outcome summary between treatment groups. If it's different, then treatment has an effect. The effect size measures the change in outcome occurrence. The change could be measured on the absolute or relative scale. That's why you see effect size expressed as difference in means, risk difference, risk ratio, or rate ratio. Here is an example. Let's say we label the outcome summary by the Greek letter mu. Changing mu from mu naught to mu 1 may be thought of as the effect of applying one treatment instead of another. Then, the effect size will be mu 1 minus mu naught, or mu 1 divided by mu naught. In health research, we compare treatment groups. Our goal is to attribute treatment outcomes to group membership. We use two types of study for this: randomized trials and observational studies. Randomized trials measure outcome difference when we apply one treatment instead of another. Observational studies look at the difference when we happen to see one treatment instead of another. In observational studies, treatment allocation is observed. And here is our challenge. Both causation and covariation manifest themselves as differences in treatment results. And we cannot tell whether a different treatment will lead to a different outcome just by looking at treatments and outcomes. We see treatments, we see outcomes, but we don't see causation. What do? We resort to reasoning. In trials, we compare treatments assigned by randomization. Remember its purpose: to make treatment groups as similar as possible. We reason they will have the same distribution of all factors that may determine the outcome. Differences in outcomes can be attributed then to being in one treatment group instead of another. In contrast, observational studies compare treatments that result from clinical decisions. This distinction matters. The distribution of outcome determinants may differ among treatment groups. And here is an important thought. If groups differ in terms of outcome determinants, we might suspect that the difference in outcome reflects the effect of those determinants and not the effect of treatment. We are now ready to state the task of causal attribution, to provide evidence that group membership rather than other factors explain differences in outcomes. We reason that randomization makes treatment groups alike. We think that adjustment for some factors rules out covariation. Then we credit changes in health to treatment. We see association, rule out covariation, and declare causation. That's a causal analysis. Much of the course will focus on group comparability, and I'll teach you how to find factors to control so that we may compare like with like. Surprisingly, it's not only the determinants of outcomes. If anything, we should control for the determinants of treatment choice. What about factors we should avoid? These are the mediators between treatment and outcomes, or their common effects. And here's the skill I'll help you to master. It's identifying variables for adjustment. For this, you need to know how to use causal diagrams. And I'll teach you how to read them. I'll show how to find the right set of variables. Adjusting for them will be more effective than using every variable inside. So, to summarize, health research compares groups receiving different treatments. The task of causal attribution is to create differences in treatment results to be in one treatment group instead of another. To do this with a scientific rigor, we frame study questions in a certain way. And here are some ideas to begin. A study variable represents treatments. It links a change in treatment to a change in the treatment outcome. Summary measure describes outcome occurrence in a single treatment group. The effect measure quantifies the difference in its occurrence between two groups. That's it for today's lesson. Make sure to receive extra material I prepared for you. Links are in description. And keep on watching.